Before coming to the main activity of this session, namely the address by the chairman, I also wanted to acknowledge that the distance education program that IIT Bombay started in a synchronous mode after planning it in 98-99, it has been almost 20 years. But the inspiration to initiate such an activity came to me personally from two individuals whom I would like to acknowledge today, because one of them is present here. One person is Professor Anup Ray of IIT Kharagpur, who, like other person that I speak of, had the problem of being ahead of time. They used the technology that was available then, namely Betamax recorders and cassettes, and they used to record lectures and circulate. The second person is the person who started that activity around the same time in IIT Bombay, although it was not so much for outreach, but for capturing records and making those available, the recorded lectures, to outside. My name is Professor Ravi Puvaiya, who is with us here. And the seeds that he had sown have grown to a very large tree, as we can see that. So, utilizing the presence of our Associate Dean, may I request Professor Anil Kulkarni to hand over a small memento to Professor Ravi Puvaiya in commemoration of him. We'll now move over to the next activity and the most important activity here. It is my privilege to introduce formally to all of you Professor Anil Sastrabuddhe, currently chairman of AICTE. Of course, he's a well-known figure, and at least all the educational institutions in the country dealing with professional education would know him very well. I'm sure many of you would have unearthed his biodata after he took over to find out what kind of a person he is. So whatever I tell you now will be perhaps a repeat, but it is important to understand the person who leads our technical education today. Professor Anil Sastrabuddhe did his graduation from BVB College. He was, of course, a gold medalist, but more than that, he was the university topper in every semester that he participated in the exam. He then went on to do his post-graduation and PhD from IIC Bangalore, and then, like all of us, joined teaching profession. He spent a lot of time in Northeast, and I'll tell you how popular he is amongst his students. We always measure the popularity by how many of your students remember you 20 years hence, 25 years hence. I had an occasion to spend some time with him when he was chief guest at the convocation of NIT Agartala a couple of years ago. At that time, the alumni of NIT Agartala, which also is a strong body, had organized an event to felicitate him in the evening. But when this was known, many of his students from the Northeast Institute and from various places, wherever they had studied under him, on their own suo moto, they assembled at that event. They were not past students of NIT Agartala, but they were past students of the institutions where Professor Anil Sastrabuddhe had taught. It was a very heartwarming feeling, and you can now see the sense of passion that Professor Sastrabuddhe carries as an educationist. Subsequently, he took over as the director of College of Engineering, Pune. And let me tell you, friends, what I have seen happening there, history has been created. A good institution, which was not doing well for several reasons, was resurrected from the dumps. Thanks, of course, to a very active chairman, the person whom I call the Bhishma Pitama of Indian IT industry, Dr. F.C. Kohli, was chairman of the board. With his active and novel support, Professor Sastrabuddhe turned around that institution. I do not know how many of you are aware, but it's now a case study in management. And in fact, efforts are being made to take that model of governance and circulate it and initiate similar things in various other institutions in the country, with some kind of a hand-holding support being provided by such mother institutions. So this is what he is doing. We are very, very happy and privileged to have Professor Sastrabuddhe with us. May I request him to share his thoughts with us.
Good morning, everyone. Dignitaries on the dais, especially Professor Deepak Phatak, who is guru of gurus. We all acknowledge him. Professor Kannan Modugalia, Professor Balaji, Professor Kulkarni, Professor Sridhar, we have Professor Chakravarti, and Professor Ravi Puvaiya, and there are other faculty also of IIT Bombay here, and most importantly, faculty members as well as principals and heads of the institutions from different AICTE approved colleges in the country who are here today for this very important two-day workshop. First day is already over, we are in the second day. I couldn't come yesterday because there was another meeting in IIC Bangalore yesterday, but I'm very delighted and happy to be amongst you on this very important occasion. There are certain reasons for that. Number one, as Professor Phatak rightly pointed out, there were a large number of T10 KT programs going on in the last couple of years, both in IIT Kharagpur as well as IIT Bombay. Large number of teachers were participating in that thanks to the support which MHRD had given. But when I took over, there was a blended learning committee which was headed by Professor Phatak, and we met here in IIT Bombay, and he said that we need to take this forward. It's not just the regular core areas of engineering whose faculty development programs are being held, but we also need to reach out on what is the importance of ICT in education, ICT enabled education, and also in the form of blended learning, you call hybrid learning, you call it as by different names, but ultimately how is the pedagogy continuously changing world over and how we need to adapt to that. And therefore we need to have a separate faculty development program initiated by AICTE. So he said, I will send a proposal. He did send a proposal, and the proposal required a very high cost. And unfortunately, it was a year when we were having a solid dip in the budget provision from the MHRD. It is in terms of, I'll tell you the numbers and you will be surprised. We were receiving about 350, 360 crore an annum, and we needed about 400 crore at least. And in the same year, the M.Tech scholarships were increased from 8,000 a month to 12,400 a month. So the budget requirement was certainly higher because of the higher amount of scholarship to be paid, including arrears. So the MHRD should have increased the budget. Instead of increasing it to about 500 crore plus, they decreased it to 250 crores. So we were totally zapped, actually. So we didn't know what to do. And in such a situation, if I start doing a program which to support such activities and don't give scholarship to our students, there will be hue and cry in the country. So I said, please hold on. Then we said, why not have a self-sustaining model developed in the process? And I think we had a lot of elaborate discussion, and we had all type of doubting Thomases, this will never work, who will come forward? But the experience which Professor Phatak just now enunciated, that when teachers who participated earlier in T10 KT program were asked whether they are willing to come on their own cost, more than 4,000 faculty were willing. I think that's the strength of our country. And I thank all those teachers who cooperated in this initiative of becoming self-sustaining model. And this is a way forward. Probably budgets are going to be not as high. Number of new institutions are increasing, whether it is IITs, IIMs, ICERS in the country. So Ministry of HRD will get a lump sum budget, which they will not be able to cater to more and more institutions with the same level as they were doing it. And therefore, we will have to evolve methodologies and mechanisms of becoming self-sustaining. And so this is one of the best models which has been evolved now. Use CSR fund from some company like SAP or someone else. Use alumni to fund some of these programs. And also ask those people who are going to be benefited in the process to pitch in their bit in the process. Because ultimately, you are the beneficiary. So our Dr. F.C. Kohli keeps saying that increase of fees should not be a problem, because a person who is getting benefit out of that good education, he will earn a lot of money in his whole lifetime. So he should be ready to pitch in that money. Maybe some of them are poor, they cannot afford education. For them, bank loans should be made available very easily without any interest rate, which is much higher. And they should pay back after they get the education. And that's why Teachers who are getting training here should be able to use that in their respective careers, and therefore they must be willing to pitch in some small amount of money, and that has worked very well, and I'm really thankful to all of you for making it a successful model. Another issue, sir, Professor Fatak, I would like to mention, when does a man or woman ready to pay that money? Only when he sees value in that. And it's a great valuable program of teaching learning. Had it been just a simple program where you say that you have to pay money and come there and there was no value added to that, I'm sure that no one would have come. Even if you pay some money, they would probably come here, but their minds will be elsewhere. But here is a case where teachers have come on their own, participated. More than 253 faculty were identified as best performing faculty. And more importantly, whether institution allows them extra benefit in terms of some amount of leeway given in terms of teaching learning, or whether they give some remuneration or not, they have come forward to become co-faculty in these programs. And that is another laudable thing from out of these faculty who have come here. And therefore, mera in sam logon ko naman hai, ye teachers ko naman hai, ki jinhone apne apne jagah se, yahan apne apne kharche se aakar ye program karne ke liye aage aaye hue hain, aur aage bhi usko apna jo bhi sahkarya dena hai wo dene ke liye taiyar hai. I think this is the greatest model that I have seen, sir. So I thank on behalf of AICTE again and again. Now coming back to people like Ravi Poveya, which was mentioned that they are visionaries, you know. These people think beyond the timelines, actually. Today we have books, today we have lots of material available on the internet, but think of 1999, emails were just coming into the fore. How do we reach out to people? And that is the time when NPTEL, using variety of mechanisms, whether it is video lectures or even audio lectures, even content which is being posted onto the website, all started happening around that time. And that's why these are the people who are visionaries. Professor Fatak mentioned about my stint at College of Engineering, Pune. I mean, really indebted that leaving IIT Guwahati, coming to College of Engineering, Pune, some of my faculty colleagues there and many elsewhere, they laughed at me. They said, what is this fellow doing? Nice job in IIT, he's leaving and coming to a College of Engineering, Pune as director. It's a typical government institution, nothing will happen. He will get totally disgusted and go back. But it was not so, because thanks to the chairman of the Board of Governors, Dr. F.C. Kohli, whose name was mentioned time and again, he's the one who was a driving force behind the transformation that happened in the college. Again, a great visionary. Today we talk about MOOCs. It was in 2006 when I joined. We had, through CDIP and College of Engineering Pune, an MOU signed, and the lectures that were given in IIT Bombay were delivered live to the students of College of Engineering Pune through a video conferencing equipment. This was not even tried probably by MIT, Harvard or anyone. But that is a time when Kohli said, this is going to be the future. So we must make use of technology that is available at that point in time, that is using video conferencing equipment. Live lectures of IIT Bombay should be made available to students of COAP. And as many as 17 courses were done that way. I think that's a starting point for many of the other initiatives which began. Today, it's very common, started with 1,000 teachers training program by Professor Fatak. 1,000 is not enough for a country of our size. I just the numbers here. In the year 15-16, in the undergraduate program under AICTE, there were as many as 4,472 colleges, as many as 4,34,394 faculty members, 4 lakh faculty members. Some of them may be used duplicate. That's a different thing which we are trying to attack. And through the PAN card and through the mechanism of Aadhaar card, we are trying to find out to duplicate ones and remove them. But nevertheless, I'm sure that at least 3 lakh plus faculty are there in our country in the engineering colleges. We have as much as 17 lakh intake capacity, of which only 9 lakh seats are getting filled. So there is a large chunk of around 8 lakh seats going unfilled as well. And out of these 9 lakh students who join the program 4 years down the line, we found that only 3.5 lakh students are getting placed through the placement cells. So that means about 1/3 are getting placed. So first half of the students are joining compared to the seats available. 1/3 of them who join are going to be getting the jobs through the placement. So this is a real challenge which AICTE as a regulatory body is facing. So being a regulator, very easy thing is there is an excess capacity of 8 lakh. So 4,472 colleges, maybe half of them, 2,000 colleges be closed is one simple phenomenon which one can think of and do it. But that will reduce our possibility of increasing the gross enrollment ratio, which today hovers around 24.5%, and the national vision and mission is to reach to 30% by 2020 itself. And the aspirational society that we are, we want to reach to 40%, 50% in higher education, and therefore reducing the colleges is not really the right thing to do, but making these colleges better, making those faculty members capable of handling better quality education is the right thing to do. And therefore, AICTE, instead of being merely a regulator, which it will continue to do, as I said, duplicate faculty will be checked where the quality of education is not good, these colleges will be asked to even reduce the number of seats, all those things will continue to happen. But what is significant and important is we need to empower our faculty, our educational institutions, so that quality of education becomes very, very good, and our technical education system will become one of the best in the world, probably the best in the world. That is the target with which vision and mission we should continue to move forward. So this use of ICT for education, pedagogy, as well as later how do we use it in either flipped classroom or blended learning is a very important topic from multiple reasons. One of the reasons which often we say is the attention span of our students in the classrooms has been reducing. Some of you, all of you, in fact, teachers who have studied about 10 years back, 20 years back, maybe 25 years back, 30 years back, we studied that time classes used to be around 55 minutes, 60 minutes, whatever. We used to be attentive throughout the lecture. We used to take down notes. Teacher used to be writing something on the board, sometime looking at you, and we used to seriously take down notes, because there was hardly anything available like on the internet today which is available. At most there were books in the library. They were also expensive. Many of us were not able to afford, so only go to the library and read them. And therefore, our way of teaching learning used to be through the teacher in the classroom. We used to take down everything. Today, with the kind of expansion of knowledge that is available plus the internet capability, students are having all that information at their doors, you know, at their doorsteps or laptops or on the mobile. And therefore, their attention in the classroom has been reducing. And worldwide, it has been said now that attention span of students in the classrooms is not more than 10 minutes. Many of them start taking out their mobile phones in the classroom, start watching Facebook or WhatsApp, and therefore, keeping the attention of students is a big challenge. And therefore, the new way of teaching learning, that is pedagogy, need to be implemented, need to be understood. And that is where this particular FDP program, where more than 4,000 teachers attended, is a game changer in that sense. And as I said, the number of faculty are of the order of 3 to 4 lakh. If only 4,000 are reached is not good enough. And that's why some of these teachers, when they have said that they become co-faculty and try to expand this base, become mentors, and that is where each teacher, when they take up another 100 teachers under their umbrella, this 4,000 will become 4 lakh in no time. And that is what we should be able to do. So each year, we should be able to train about 100 teachers from each one of us in the new methodology of teaching learning, and that will make all the colleges in the country self-sustainable in terms of this new methodology of teaching learning. Now, once again, coming back to what we need to do in this particular case, there must be empowerment in different ways. Professor Fatak mentioned that each faculty member at assistant professor level is required to have a teaching load of, say, 16 hours. For associate professor, 14 hours. For HODs and professors, 12 hours. These are all norms. Many a times in many of the colleges, they keep on fighting with the head of the institution. So my load is 16 hours. I have crossed that 17 hours this time. But some other year, some other semester, it is only 14 hours. That we never reflect. we always talk about the semester in which I am required to take more load. In College of Engineering, Pune, I used to always joke, we should not consider this as a load at all. Load is one which is like a difficult, you know, so you are carrying a load of 100 kilogram, then we feel very bad about it. When we say that this is an opportunity which is given by the college to me to teach 1 hour extra, you should feel excited and elated, because being a teacher, my first job is to teach, and therefore if I am getting 1 or 2 hours extra, I will take it with all pleasure, and that is the spirit with which our teachers should start doing it. And that will happen only when people like Professor Fatak will show the way. So I always keep saying his name is so wonderful, Deepak Fatak. Deepak is the diya. It lights one lamp, that lamp will light another lamp, and you can light lakhs of lamps, and that is the lakhs of teachers who are being illuminated. He has a Fatak in Marathi. Fatak is like a gate. He opens the gate of education and empowerment for all our people. So I think God has some destiny in naming, Professor Deepak Fatak. As I said, Guru of Gurus, and I have learned from him in a big way. Not directly, but whenever he comes to any program, every 15 minutes, 20 minutes he speaks, he gives an excellent example, and it carries the message across the board. And I think all of us should emulate Professor Fatak and become noble teachers like him. And if you commit like that, I'm sure there is no dearth of good quality education in this country. So this is what it is. And of course, I have to mention everyone from IIT Bombay, whoever are involved in the CDIP, whether it is Professor Shevgaonkar, whether it is Professor Kannan Modugulia, and now young man Sridhar Iyer, each one of them, Ravi Povaya, I think the names are, they're all great teachers, and we should take a leaf out of their lives and try to implement that in our lives. Professor Kulkarni, I know that his students who are there in College of Engineering Pune keep often telling about the way he conducts himself and the way he interacts with them. One of the most important thing each faculty has to remember is that our most important stakeholder is student. And therefore, how do we interact with students is very, very important, which is becoming difficult these days, no doubt, because of the way students also behave. But it is, our behavior is also equally important. We often say that moral education should be given, value education should be given. If it is given in the form of a theoretical lecture, and there are some courses being implemented in many institutions, a mandatory 2-credit course, 3-credit course on value education. Such courses are meaningless, in fact, in many ways. You may learn what is to be done, but whether I will do it like that or not is the most important thing. I quote this from an example which I had recently. The Indian Administrative Services, that UPSC, conducts an examination. You all know, most of your students will be appearing for that at times. And there is a paper on ethics. And this paper is mandatory. So one of the candidates who was in the top 100 in IAS and who scored the highest marks in that ethics paper, while he was undergoing his training in Mussoorie in the academies, Lal Bahadur Shastri Academy, where they have to go, the teachers there, they said that he was the most unethical fellow in the class. So if that is the kind of ethics paper we write, there is no use. So ethics is not to be taught through a coursework. Ethics is to be followed by following the practices our elders do it. That starts, of course, from the houses itself. We have this standard joke that a phone call comes and the child lifts it. And the fellow on the other side says, is your father there at home? Father is watching that. He says, don't say that I'm there at home. And he learns that we have to lie. You know, right from their childhood, this starts. Then whether it is in the examinations, in the question papers, the way we operate, the way we talk to students, I think everywhere What we do is observed by our students, and therefore behavior of students is a live example of ethics actually. And if we behave ethically in all manners, in all matters of our behavior, I'm sure that our students will pick up from that. And we always remember our teachers, whoever, whatever you say, teachers will be remembered after 25 years, 30 years, 50 years. And therefore we have a great responsibility in our part. And whatever new methodology of teaching learning is happening, we have to adopt that. We have to start doing it in the manner in which IITs are doing. I'm sure that we will all be able to lift our technical education system. Now I'll come back to few important initiatives AICTE has taken up. The reason being, I'm getting all these teachers in one go. So I should reflect upon the changes that are happening. As I said, it's not merely a regulator, but more as a facilitator, many important initiatives have been undertaken. A few of them I will highlight so that you take them forward, make use of those particular initiatives. As I said, budget was dwindling, MHRD was not giving money. And many of the research promotion schemes, enhancement of equipment in the institutions, faculty development programs, they were all suffering in the last 2 years. So what we did was, we had a corpus which was generated. The interest earned on that, we wanted to use it for this purpose. And therefore, this year, despite budget being not provided by MHRD, AICTE on its own has launched all the programs. You must have observed that this year we had a short duration of 15 days when applications were invited for all variety of quality improvement programs, and many of them are getting selected. We will give out all those lists and also funding immediately in the next fortnight. So that is a new change which we have said. If government doesn't give, we will generate our own resources and try to continue funding so that quality of education is not hampered. This is number one. Last year, we did another important thing. Everywhere there is faculty shortage, whether it is IITs, whether it is NITs, everywhere we say that there is 25-30% shortage in faculty members. So we said that only 80% of the regular faculty members required as per the student faculty ratio of 1:15 need to be regular. Remaining 20% could be drawn as adjunct faculty from the industry. So it has multiple benefits. One is you will have that shortage overcome. The second important thing is you will start interacting with industry to get those 20% faculty to your institutions. And in the process, not only industry experience comes to the classrooms directly, you make friends with industry people, and therefore asking for your students' internships becomes easy. You'll get live projects from industry. Your quality of projects will improve. I think there are a lot of spin-off benefits as well. This is one important thing. Second thing is we always crib that good quality students do not come for teaching. So there are many initiatives which have been taken by MHRD also. It's coming in the IIT Council in short while now. We want to catch young bright students to teaching profession. How do we do it? When you observe that in a class someone is very bright, he is a likely potential teacher, you encourage him not to apply for job but to become a teacher. And even if he is B.Tech, ask him that you go for doing M.Tech. M.Tech normal scholarship, as I said, 12,400 per month will anyway come because of GATE. But additional 2.5 lakh per annum will be supported by AICTE for such bright students so that they complete their masters, come back to the college as teacher. You give him an advance appointment 2 years down the line that after M.Tech, this job is available for you. And AICTE will in turn support you. So this is how we can get young, bright students back to education, back to teaching. We have a scheme of called Margadarshan. Professor Fatak again said that a college being transformed through autonomy should not sit in isolation and boast about itself, but try to help other institutions to come up like that. And therefore, a scheme called Margadarshan is floated. Any good autonomous institution which is accredited may apply for this scheme and help 10 other institutions in the neighborhood in the same way to come up in their particular programs. You know, that is also a possibility. We also talk about Unnat Bharat Abhiyan. There is a support available for the students to go to the villages, find out what are the challenging problems there, try to solve them, and that will also sensitize our students towards the problems of the society, rural areas, etc. So these are four important schemes which were launched last year. This year, a very important initiative is ongoing. You are all aware that on 1st and 2nd April, Smart India Hackathon is taking place. We announced this through support from 29 government departments. They gave their 598 problem statements, which they were having. They are being solved by our students in the form of a hackathon, 36-hour long hackathon. More than 10,000 students simultaneously will, you know, find digital solutions, whether it is mobile apps or software, on April 1 and 2 in 26 different cities, probably one of the largest such initiative taken by AICTE. This has again multiple benefits. It is not just that the problems of the government are being solved, but we say that students do not know problem solving ability. This gives them problem solving ability. They will be able to see what are the nature of problems that this, you know, state is facing, how do they act upon that. This will also make them team players, because six people have to do it together. Minimum one girl student is enclosed into this particular stream, so that there is a gender equity involved into this. It is a 36-hour, you know, therefore you need to do time management. You need to communicate what you have done to the judges, therefore communication skills are also important. I think variety of things which industry keeps saying that students are not having will be provided through this particular one single initiative. We have a startup initiative, startup program launched by the Honorable President, and according to this, students can have courses in entrepreneurship, business plan making, angel funding into the courses along with their normal civil, mechanical, electrical, electronics courses. Thereby, instead of seeking jobs, at the end of 4 years, most of these students should be able to have their own startups from the portals of the colleges themselves. And if in the next 10 years, these 10,000 odd technical colleges, even half of them start doing it, more than a lakh such startups will emanate, more than millions of jobs will be created. You know, that is a possibility, and we need to work hard on through that. And last but not the least, AICTE is given a responsibility of having a MOOCs platform called Swayam, and this is already being undertaken. First phase is already rolled out, second and third phase is ongoing. AICTE and UGC has allowed 20% of the courses to be taken in the MOOCs manner. And that's why this particular course, which enables teachers to learn ICT methodologies in teaching learning, should be able to make use of a best possible course from a best possible IIT to be taken by any student in the country. And 20% of such courses, one-fifth of them, you can imagine that the kind of empowerment that is going to be possible for the students of our country. Very recently in the council meeting held last week, we made three important significant announcements. One of them is single entrance examination for all engineering students. I don't know whether people have appreciated, but we get congratulatory notes, but so far no one has opposed that. We want that students should not suffer by writing several such examinations, but single examination, and the quality also will be tested. So where they are entering, there will be a minimum quality ensured. The second is a mandatory faculty induction program. See, we are talking about faculty induction. So a mandatory faculty induction program, unless you go through a module of 2 months or 3 months, which is going to be designed, a person with even M.Tech qualification will not be allowed to enter into the teaching profession, so that all the new nuances will be taken care of. Not alone in the induction, but during service, since the changes are so rapid, technology is changing so rapidly, every 5 years one has to go through in-service training, which may be again a program of this nature, T10 KT, or maybe in person attending some of the faculty development programs. Unless you do that, you will not be able to continue in this profession. I think this is very significant and important, and I appeal to all the principals who are here to support our faculty members in undertaking that. Whether it is available under CAS or not, immaterial, but of course AICTE on its part will make it mandatory, and also for career advancement scheme, minimum number of such courses have to be done. Only then they will get promotions to the higher level. So it is in the interest of students, it is in the interest of faculty, it is in the interest of the managements of the colleges as well. We also introduced another phenomenon which is called mandatory internship. It's a very big challenge. We are working with MSMEs, we are working with large scale industries, CII, NASCOM, all industry bodies, asking them to support for internship so that students during their second year vacation, third year vacation can go to industry, have hands-on experience and come back, and thereby their employability will improve, and some of them who learn some of the methodologies can have their own startups. I think a variety of actions are happening. My once again appeal to all faculty members who are here is please support T10KT program, whether government supports or not. It is my initiative, our initiative. This is the philosophy with which we move forward. I'm sure that we will be able to transform the education system in this country. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Sarvade, for elaborating very many important points. In the same vein, I would like to add one more suggestion which came from the participating faculty yesterday, that in the accreditation process, if a parameter could be included as to how many faculty members from an institution are trained in using technology for education, I think that would help. So that was one suggestion.
I'm sorry, I did not reflect upon that. You already talked about this with the MBA.
MBA is a separate entity. It's not part of AICTE now.
Correct.
So I have talked to Professor Surendra Prasad and Professor NASA.
Okay.
Professor S.C. Sastravudha is also part of the team. We will ask him also to pitch this into action.
Okay,
okay, thank
very
you.
Good. Thank you. Before calling Professor Kannan, I'd like to share with you the presence of another important person, Professor D.A. Mehta from SJSITS Indore. He is the chairman of the Technical Advisory Committee, which we had formed in conjunction with a consortium of about 50 autonomous institutions, which did the first ever experiment of running a regular blended MOOCs program, where they combined their students' learning from MOOCs and face-to-face, and they factored the online scores into their regular grades. So for this purpose, a MIS system and dashboard has been created by IIT Bombay by extending the open source platform. And the features in that platform are to be decided on a continuous basis by a technical advisory group comprising of professionals and faculty members from the participating members of the consortium. That group is headed by Professor D.A. Mehta, and over the next 2 months, we'll be releasing outline of the modified process, and we'll be actually initiating a blended MOOC thing on a much larger scale from the coming semester. So this is what I wanted to inform.